Can you hear, Pallavi?
Yeah, I can hear. This is starting 4 minutes.
Can I share the presentation?
Yeah, sure.
I've never used this Zoom application.
Okay.
Can you see it? Can you see the presentation?
Oh, yeah. Titus.
Ah, Pallavi, so you record the meeting?
Yeah.
Okay, so can you send me afterwards the link?
Yeah, sure. Link of what? Webex meeting or recording?
No, so of the recording afterwards.
Sure. So we have classes till 5:30, so that's why students take a little bit time to join.
Yeah, sure. I mean, I'd wanted to join some minutes before to see that everything works. And I have 45 minutes, 50, something like this.
Up to you. It's
Okay.
Python, it's open, it's okay, plus minus. Okay, so I guess now we can start.
Okay.
So, hello everyone, welcome to the first series of the year. Today we have Dr. Nimrod with us, and he is a researcher and lecturer in Ben Gurion University and a consultant in Weizmann Institute of Sciences, Israel. His main research interests include the development and analysis of algorithms in the context of computational social choice, e-democracy, and social networks. He has ADOS number 3, Sabbath number 7, and arguably Bacon number 6. So, in case you don't know about these numbers, please feel free to ask him.
Okay.
what do you know, Nimrod?
Okay, thanks. Thanks, Pallavi, for inviting me and for introducing me. So if you have any questions during my talk, please don't hesitate to. What I meant for this talk is basically a kind of a high-level view of the research that people, including me, do in participatory budgeting. To somehow give the overview of what kind of questions people are interested in and what more things there are to do in this subject. Okay, so I hope that you can hear me and see me and see the presentation nicely. If not, please tell me. Okay, so let's start. So, participatory budgeting is a quite recent idea. It's initiated in the 90s in Brazil. The idea is to decide upon the distribution of public funds using direct democracy and not by some opaque decision-making procedure, or figuratively to somehow decide how to use public funds, not in the confined area of the mayor of the city, for example, but to ask the participants, the people that will be affected by the decisions directly, and they will decide together how to use them. The common funds that they have together. So, as I said, this was initiated in Brazil in the 90s, but since then it's became quite increasingly popular throughout the world. So you can see on the left side there is a map. It's not quite updated, but each yellow and red mark marks a place in the world in which people have done and currently doing budgeting process. Pallavi, I think that you have some noise from your mic, so if you can. Okay, and maybe the best example is Paris. So they have each year something like 100 euros, 100 million euros from the budget of the city they decide how to use it using a process of participatory budgeting. So basically, they ask residents of Paris to suggest projects like building a new school or renovating playground and stuff like this. Then each of the projects get assigned some monetary cost. Then they say that, okay, we want to spend 100 million euros on this project, but we cannot fund all of them. So there is a second phase of voting in which residents of Paris can come to the voting booth, and each of them declares which of the projects they like. And then there is some algorithm that takes all of the votes and decides which of the funds to take. So this is usually how participatory budgeting is done. And there is a recent law in Poland, just as another example of place in the world in which participatory budgeting is increasing in popularity. So in Poland, there is a law that each city from some number of residents must have some participatory budgeting process in the coming years. Okay, so when I first started to think about this subject, I asked my daughter which algorithm she thinks is most suitable for aggregating the votes of the people. So I explained to her the following scenario. I said that her teacher comes to class and says that, okay, I have $30. It was 30 shekels because it's in Israel, but let's say $30. And in the class, you have 30 kids. So you can decide together how to spend these $30. So I asked Lotan what method or what mechanism she thinks is the best mechanism to decide for the class together how to use these $30. And she said the following mechanism. So she said, okay, we are 30 students, and the teacher gives us $30. So let's divide the $30 into 30 students so that each student gets $1, and then each student can decide on its own, on her own, how to spend this $1. So this mechanism is simple, which is nice. It's also very fair because each student gets the same amount of money to decide independently. But maybe it doesn't really take into account the main reason for doing participatory budgeting is to somehow allow the community as a whole to make decisions that are maybe resulting in funding more expensive projects or more expensive things. So if they can jointly decide how to spend the $30 on something that costs $30 or something that is more than $1, then maybe this is better. So this is one mechanism. Then I asked another scenario and I say, okay, you have your brother, and let's say that I give you $20 and ask you and your brother together to decide how to spend this $20 and what mechanism you think is the best to decide it. And then she said, it's real dictatorship, which basically means that I would give her the $20, then she will decide what to do with the $20, and the remainder goes to her brother, and her brother can decide what to do with the remaining funds. So if you decide who will begin this iterative algorithm or iterative mechanism, if you decide it randomly, then this is called random serial dictatorship. And this has the nice property that it's strategy proof in the sense that each person would really declare the preferences that they have without doing any strategic consideration, but it doesn't seem very fair. So it seems that some participants in the mechanism will be more happy than others. So maybe this is not a very good mechanism. So let me give you a more concrete setting that is usually done. So this is from Cambridge in 2015. You can see below the instructions that the city gave to the voters. So basically, each resident ages 12 and over can vote, and each one can select at most 5 projects. And the ballot looks like this. So here you see only part of the ballot with 10 projects. For each project, you see the name of the project. So, for example, on the top right, you can see this bike repair station, and this costs $12,000. And there are other projects. And then each person comes to the voting booth and can select or cross at most 5 projects. And then what the city gets, they get all of the votes of the people. And they can decide whatever algorithm they want to decide or to use to somehow aggregate those ballots together. And what they decide is to do the following. So basically, order all of the projects in decreasing order of the number of votes that they get. So for example, this project of planting 100 new trees, there was slightly above 1400 people voting for it, I mean crossing it in the ballots. And this was the highest, the most popular project. And the second popular project was these computers to build or to buy to someplace in the city with slightly less voters and so on. So what the city in this case did, they order all of the projects in this decreasing order. And then they said upfront that they have $500,000 to spend on this participatory budgeting process. Sure.
No,
So they have $500,000 to spend on this process. And then they start to fund projects going from top to down. So they say, okay, we still have money to fund this project, this 100 new trees, so we fund it and so on. So on and so forth, and then the money runs out when they reach this free outdoor Wi-Fi, and then they decide to also fund it. And this was the final decision that they made. Any questions so far? Okay, so I see a question in chat. Okay, I didn't know that there is chat here. No, so if you decide in this way, this is quite fast. I mean, you just need to go. So the question in the chat is whether it won't be too time consuming to decide in such a way. So basically, you take the votes, and for each project, you count how many votes it gets, and then you go according to this list. So you only need to sort the list, which takes n log n, it's not a lot of time, and then you go linearly on the list. Any other questions? Okay, well, let me give you the formal model of participatory budgeting. So we have a set of items, P1 to PM. Items or project, this is things that people suggest maybe to fund. And we have a cost function that gives some integer cost to each of the projects, saying that P2 cost $1,000, let's say, and P3 cost $5,000, and so on. And then we have a set of voters, P1 to VN. Now, to make the model concrete, you have to decide how the voters gives you the preferences over the projects. What is usually done is what I showed you before. So if people go to the voting booth and they see the list of projects and they decide a subset of the votes of the project that they approve of. So this is called approval ballots. So each voter is basically giving you a subset of the project. Other elicitation method that people use is ordinal. Basically, each voter needs to give a ranking or permutation of the project, saying this is the project that I like the most, this is the project that I second like, and so on. And a third kind that I will speak about it also later, it's called cumulative, which you can think about that each person gets a virtual coin and they can split it. So I can say that 50% of my support goes to project P1, 30% go to project P2, and so on. So we have these items, P1 to PM, which is a cost, and we have N votes, let's say approval votes, and we have a limit, L, which is also a natural integer number, saying how much money we want to spend in this process in total. And then what a budgeting method or budgeting or aggregation algorithm needs to do, so it takes all of this input, it takes the ballots of the voters and the project with their cost and the total budget that you have, this L, and the algorithm shall return a bundle of the project, or so a subset of the project. This project will be funded, this is the project that will be selected. And the only restriction that the algorithm shall adhere to is that the total cost of the project that the algorithm selects respect this budget limit. So it cannot be that the budgeting method, the algorithm selects project whose cost is more than the amount of money that you have to spend in this process. Okay, so this is the standard model of participatory budgeting, and this is what the main issue is somehow to find a good aggregation method. Was there any question? Okay.
No, I think this is excellent. Yeah. So you can continue on your.
Alabi, you want to say something?
Sorry?
I thought that you wanted to ask something.
No, no, this is a question. No, no, no. No, no, this is a question.
General, somehow, framing of this work. So, the staff field of artificial intelligence or computer science deals with this kind of voting mechanisms or aggregation methods. It's called the computational social choice. So, there is also a handbook and quite a vivid community. And the standard, or let's say the classical setting, is called single winner elections, in which you have a set of candidates and you want to select one candidate. Say you want to select the president of the United States, so you take all of the candidates for election, and then you have to decide how will voters go to the voting booth and will give you the preferences, and what algorithms you want to use to aggregate the votes, and what you want as the output of this aggregation algorithm is just one winner. Basically, the president, for example. This is the classical setting. And this was generalized to multi-win elections in which you want to select out of this possibly big group of candidates, you want to select a committee of size K, some given size K. And then in this context, you can see that participatory budgeting basically generalizes these multi-winner elections, that generalizes single-winner elections in the sense that now we have a set of projects, but they are not of the same cost, and we have some budget limit, and we want to select a subset of the project. So this is the overall context of participatory budgeting in this case. Okay, so after, now that hopefully all of us get the idea of what is participatory budgeting, and maybe you have some thoughts about which budgeting algorithms are perhaps better than others, or what would be a good way to design. The votes that you want to use, I want to somehow review some better answer this kind of. First is this idea that can each voter simply selects that they approve. If you have projects, then each vote is like a binary vector. But otherwise, each another question is how approach. And what you have to do is to define the happiness function. This is a formalized function. This is me, this is my vote. On the left, you see ABD. So let's say that we have project A, B, C, D, E, F, G, and so on.
Nimrod, I think slides are closed now.
I select A, B, and D. So I select this. What you see this slide is a frame of.
So I can see this only A, B, D slide. So there is no slide on A, B, C, D, E, F that you were saying. I can send you a screenshot.
But you can say this is my vote ABD. Ah, okay.
Currently I saw this a framework for approval based budgeting method slide, which is by you and
Yes,
Piotr.
yes, yes.
Okay,
Yes.
sure. Taking some more.
Is it coming back?
Sure. Yeah.
Algorithm that select ACD as the forum of the election, so as the project to find. Then what I want to define is to define the function that will tell to me how happy I am supposed to be from this bundle. So, for example, if I vote for ABD and the winning bundle is ACD, then you see that two of the projects that I approve of are really selected. So then maybe my happiness value could be defined to be two. So this is one example of the happiness function that takes a ballot, takes a vote, and a possible outcome, a bundle, and gives a numerical value, formalizing how what is the utility of this voter, the satisfaction of this voter. And you can think about other kind of happiness functions. And then, given some happiness function, you can define an aggregation method or a voting rule in various ways. One way to be to say, okay, so now I want to find, given some concrete happiness function, I want to find a bundle that will maximize the happiness function when I sum it over the voters. So I want to find the bundle that now, if I pick this bundle as the result of the election, and I compute the satisfaction of all of the voters from this bundle, and I sum over this happiness, then I will get the maximum value. Right, so this is one way to somehow take this happiness function and use it to define the voting rule for participatory budgeting. Right, so one way is to try to maximize the sum over the voters of the happiness. Another way is to maybe maximize the minimum over the voters, so to try to maximize the happiness of the voter that will be the least happy. And you can also try to do it greedily. So you can take a happiness function and just define the greedy procedure that keeps funding more projects and more projects. In each iteration, you want to fund the project that will increase the total satisfaction, for example, the most. Total happiness. Right, so to define the voting rule in this framework, what you have to do, you have to pick or define, declare some happiness function, and then you have to pick some way to use this happiness function, for example, try to maximize the sum of happiness, and this gives you a voting rule. So, for example, let's consider one specific voting rule. Let's call it algo. And this is the algorithm that goes with the happiness function, which is the size of intersection between the set of projects that some voter selects and the set of projects selected by the algorithm. So the happiness of the voter is simply the number of projects that the voter approves and are indeed funded by the algorithm, is the happiness function. And let's say that algo is the algorithm that tries to maximize the sum over the voters of this value. So put in other words, it's simply the algorithm that tries to find the set of projects. So that now if you consider the voters, it will maximize the number of projects approved by a voter and also funded when you sum it over the voters. So this is the algorithm. And if you really want to compute the winning bundle for this algorithm, then one simple algorithm would be to just go over all of the possible bundles that you can maybe output and select the one for which the total happiness is the maximum, but this will be too expensive in time because you have to consider exponential number of possibilities of the project available. But actually, you can maybe see the even though knapsack is empty-handed in general. For this particular case, you can solve it using dynamic programming in polynomial time. So this algorithm can really be, or this aggregation mechanism can really be solved efficiently. And when you think about it, then basically the greedy algorithm that I showed you before, that basically order the project by the number of approvals and start to fund one by one, this is can be viewed simply as a greedy approximation algorithm to the algorithm algo. So this sometimes will give you the maximum total happiness, but in sometimes it will not give you the maximum amount because it's only a greedy approximation to it. And because of standard techniques, you can see that it gives you 66% approximation. So it will give you at least 66% of the total happiness that you can have, but maybe it will not give you the total one. Okay, so this is one thing that we try to do. But still, maybe you still have the uneasy feeling that it's not clear to use in practice. So in particular, it's not clear which happiness function you should define. And it's not clear how you should use the happiness function, and also maybe there are other aggregation methods that you might use. And now what people try to do is to find the principal ways to decide which algorithm would be the best to use for participatory budgeting. And there are many, or at least several approaches how to make this choice in a principal way. One of them is indeed to see the complexity of computing the bundles, because maybe it's not very practical to use the aggregation method which is empty-hard, or at least there is not known polynomial time algorithm for it. A second very, I think, successful approach is to define the properties that you maybe want the algorithm to adhere to. So for example, you basically can list the desired properties you want that from the aggregation method to have. And then you can see whether one algorithm satisfies all of the desired axioms, so whether it does not. And maybe you can then use an algorithm that satisfies the properties that you want to be satisfied for participatory budgeting. And the third approach to somehow be able to decide which algorithm to use is to do simulations or experiments with other real-world data or simulated, artificially generated data. Actually, we made this website, this pabulib.org, in which we collected quite a few instances of participatory budgeting, almost 400 and growing. Of places in the world in which people have done participatory budgeting. So in all of these places, the elicitation method, basically the ballot type, is approval. So voters gives you approval, and the aggregation method is this greedy aggregation from before. So you order the project and you fund it according to this decreasing number of approvals. And what you try to do is basically to take this real-world data and to use different algorithms and to see how they behave. You can see that different algorithms indeed behave differently for different real-world data. And somehow from analyzing the output that you get, you can reason hopefully better about which algorithm you want to use for the next instance of participatory budgeting. And so this is real-world data, and of course you can try also with artificial data to see how the algorithms behave. Okay, so one, and if you recall this idea of defining axiomatic properties or desired properties that you want your aggregation method to satisfy, then one example is the following paper, in which we took the point of view of saying that what is most important in participatory budgeting is to have the project that the algorithm selects are somehow proportional to the population. So, for example, if you take the standard aggregation method, this greedy algorithm, and let's say that in your city, you have a majority of 70% of the population living in one neighborhood, and there is only a second neighborhood in which all of the remaining 30% people are living, then maybe all of the 70% people from the majority are going to select the same kind of project, and all of the 30% people will select also the same kind of different project. Then maybe what you will have if you use this greedy algorithm, you will have that you will only fund projects that the majority of the people like, but you will completely disregard this 30% minority. And this is maybe something that you don't want to be happening in an algorithm for participatory budgeting, because maybe you really want to somehow spend 70% of the common funds on the majority neighborhood and 30% of the funds on the minority neighborhood. So we try to formalize this notion of proportionality, and the intuition for the axiom is the following. So you somehow want the situation to be so that if you have a group of voters that is some reasonable size, let's say 10% of the population, and these 10% of the population are quite cohesive in the sense that they somehow vote for similar things, or at least there are some projects that all of them approve of, then you don't want to somehow disregard these votes altogether. You want to spend at least some amount or some percentage of your common funds, of the available funds, on this project that this group of voters like. So put it slightly more formal, and let's say that capital V is the total set of voters. And now what we require from an aggregation algorithm is to have the following. So that for each voter group V prime, such as the size of the voter group is sufficiently large, exactly at least n over L, where n is the total number of voters and capital L is the total amount of funds that you have to spend. So each voter group V prime with this property, and also such that there is at least one project that all of these voters approve of, then it cannot be that in the winning bundle, in the output of the algorithm, there is no project from the project that this voter group like that is funding. So at least one of the project that at least one of the voters in V prime approve of is going to be funded for me. So this voter group shall not be completely disregarded or ignored. Right, so this is an example of one axiom that tried to somehow catch this idea of having proportional budget. Okay, so then we say, okay, this is the axiom that we want to be satisfied. And now the natural question is whether there is indeed an algorithm that can satisfy this axiom, whether there is indeed an algorithm that is able to somehow not disregard these large and cohesive groups. And the answer is rather delicate. So there are various variants for this axiom, some of which we can show that sometimes there is not a solution. So for some variants of the axiom, there is no algorithm that can satisfy them just because the axioms are too strong. For some of the other variants of this axiom, it's always possible to satisfy, but there is no polytime algorithm that can do this. So this is also maybe not very good. But for some other variants, indeed, we can find the polynomial algorithms that satisfy, that can really find the good and the proportional bundles for each instance of the Is there any questions so far? Okay, so let's see how much time. Okay, so I have slightly some more time. So I want to briefly discuss another approach that we took. And this approach regards even an earlier stage in the design of participatory budgeting process. So the main two decisions that someone has to do when they want to do participatory budgeting, first is to decide upon the ballot type, what kind of information you are going to ask voters or participants to give you in the voting booth. This is the first question of preference elicitation. And then the second question is, given some ballot type, what is the algorithm that you want to use? But first, we want to suggest using a different kind of ballot. So instead of using approval ballots, in which each voter gives you just a subset of their project, and we want to suggest using cumulative ballots. So what is cumulative ballot? On the left, you can see approval ballot. So each voter simply cross some of the projects. And on the right, you can see cumulative ballots. And the way to think about it is like each voter is getting some virtual artificial coin, and he should spread his one coin over the project. So for example, this voter says that they give 0.2 support to one project, 0.5 support to another project, 0.3 support to a third project, and that's it, because they spread the total support of one. So this gives a more fine-grained preference type. So this is a highly more flexible to the voters and give them more expressive power. This is the good thing, and the bad thing is that maybe this is too complicated for voters to. Sorry? Okay. Okay, so let's say that we want to use these cumulative ballots. So basically, as an input to the aggregation algorithm, we have n ballots, and each of them looks like this. So each of them looks like, again, you can think about it as a vector of size m, but now the vector is not binary like in approval ballots, but now the vector is with real values between 0 and 1, and the sum of the values in the vector should be exactly 1. Right? This is one vote, and we have n votes, and now based on these n votes, we should decide what is going to be the winner of the election, or what is going to be the winning bundle, so which project we want to fund. So there are many ways in which you can do this, but let me explain to you one algorithm for this setting. So let's say that, think about it, that you have these L coins. This is the, let's say, 100 million euros that Paris is investing in participatory budgeting this year. And you have voters, these are the voters, so you have n voters. So think about it figuratively as if each voter is getting exactly L over n of the total amount of coins. And now each voter basically gives some support to each of the projects. Let's say in this example we have four projects, this school, hospital, police, and fire department. And each project got its own cost. And let's visualize the cost of the project by this empty glass. So if a project is more costly, then the glass may be more, maybe higher or lower. And now let's say that this voter in the top put 0.2 of her support to school and 0.8 support to this high school. So now you can take out of this L over N coins that this voter gets from the city, you can take 20% and put in this glass, and 80% and put in this glass, and you can do this for all of the voters. So now you will have that some of the glasses maybe remain empty. So a glass empty, it means that none of the voters gave support for this project. Some of them may be half empty and half full. Some of them may be exactly full. And some of them may be even overflow, right? Because if there is a project that costs 100 coins, but it gets more support, then maybe the coins are spilled over the glass. So now what the algorithm does, basically you select one of the glasses which is full, if there is a glass that is full, select one of them, and then you fund this project. So police is going to be funded. And now the excess coins, the coins that are over the cost of the project, will be maybe moved to other glasses, right? So for example, if this voter gave support to police and to hospital, and now we decide to fund the police, then maybe some of the coins will get back to the voters, and we will put the coins in the hospital instead. So then the coins are not going to be lost in a sense. So now we keep iterating and iterating. If at some point there is no project that has sufficient support, in the sense that the glass is that there is no glass that is full, then we just take a glass which is the least full and we eliminate it and take the support to other projects. And we keep iterating until there is no more funds left. So this is okay. There's some question. Okay, how do you do tie breaking if two glasses have the same coins? Yeah, so you have to do tie breaking somehow. This is always an issue in voting algorithms or in voting mechanisms. For example, if the situation would be that Hillary and Trump will get the same amount of votes, and also you have to make a decision. This rarely happens, but so you can do the decision randomly or arbitrarily, basically. So I think that if I remember correctly, I read the law in Warsaw, in Poland, and because in Warsaw they do participatory budgeting, and they say that if there is a tie, then what should happen is that the mayor should split a coin, and then they decide which of the projects to fund and which not to fund. So you can do something like this. Okay, so we basically took this algorithm and we compared the results from the election in Warsaw. So in Warsaw they used the same greedy algorithm that I showed you before. So we took the ballots or the votes from Warsaw and we ran them through this algorithm as well. And what we could see is that the happiness of the voters, at least in the way that we measure it, is higher. So what is the happiness of the voter? Let's say that the voter approves some three projects and then the algorithm funds two of them. Then the happiness of the voter is two. So we computed the average happiness of a voter and we see that we get quite a significant increase in the happiness. So this maybe means that these algorithms could be better appreciated by voters. And what is another, I think, very important property of this algorithm that the other algorithm, this greedy algorithm, does not have, is that it's proportional in the sense that I discussed before, that minority groups really get some hold of the common funds, as long as they are cohesive enough and large enough. Right, so this is somehow two properties that we want. We want to have high happiness of the voters from the outputs, and we want the output to be proportional. Okay, so let me end by giving some hints on some other considerations that maybe you want to put thought into when you want to do some participatory budgeting process. So one of them is interactions or relations between projects. So the way participatory budgeting is done is that basically people can give you preferences over the voter, saying, okay, over the project, this project I like, this I don't like, this I like more than this, and so on. But they never can tell you preferences concerned with the interaction between projects. But in many cases, there are. So, for example, a voter can think to himself that would be happy with funding some school, but only if there is some bus stop next to it. So if there will be one project saying funding a school, and there is another project P2 saying building a bus stop, then maybe the voter will not be happy if the algorithm will select only the school but with no bus stop, or vice versa. So there is no reason to put a bus stop if there is no school. But this is one toy example of a positive correlation between projects. So my happiness is not just for individual projects, but is also affected by groups of projects or by the interaction between projects. So what would be a good way to somehow take into consideration this kind of interaction between projects? There are many, many ways. And one way that we took in this paper is to say the following. Let's say that there is some partition over the project. So for example, consider the set of projects being P1 to P10. And let's say that there is some agreed upon partition. Let's say, for example, that P1, P2, P3 is one part, P4 to P8 is the second part, and P9 and P10 is the third part. For example, P9 could be the project of the school, and P10 could be the project of building a bus stop. And now, if a voter would like P9 and P10, then if P9 will be funded but P10 will not be funded, then maybe the happiness of the voter should be counted as one. And also, if P10 is funded but P9 is not, then maybe the happiness should be also one. But now, if P9 and P10 are jointly funded, so if both are going to be funded, then because we said that there is some positive synergy or correlation between this project, maybe the happiness of the voter from this output bundle should be more than two. Right? So this is a different way to say that the sum is greater than the value of its parts. So the happiness of for me for from P9 is maybe one. The happiness of me from P10 is also maybe one. But the joint happiness from having both funded, so having a school also with a bus stop, maybe this is more. Maybe this is more than two. And in general, you can think that there is this partition over the project, and also some function that formalizes what is the correlation or the synergies between the projects. And the function will tell you what is the happiness of a voter from one part, for which the number of projects that are approved and funded in this part is some number. So, for example, if there is one project from this part that is approved and funded, then my happiness is one. If there are two projects, then my happiness maybe is more than two because there is positive synergy. Maybe my happiness is three or four. And if there are three, maybe my happiness even increases to 10 or to 20. So given this partition and some synergy function, we can now also take the same approach from before and say that we want to find the winning bundle that will now maximize the happiness of the voters, but now the happiness of the voters is defined with respect to this partition of the project and this synergy function. So this is the approach that we took here, and as you maybe imagine, really finding bundles that maximize the total satisfaction, it's NP-hard, but we do have some approximation, and if some of the parameters of the problems are small, or input otherwise, if you consider some special cases, then we can still find an efficient algorithm that will fund winning bundles that make the sum of happiness of the voters to be maximized when taking into account this interaction between projects. Okay, so one last thing that I want to mention is a different additional consideration that concerns with diversity constraints. So, for example, let's say that you have some subject of the project. So, some of the projects concerned with education. Some of them are concerned with culture and some concerned with some other things. What you maybe don't want to happen is that all of the funds will go to projects that concern with education, for example, and none of the funds will go to projects concerned with culture. So this kind of diversity constraints with regard to the output that the algorithm gives you is something like if you want to select a committee, maybe you don't want the committee to be consisting only of men or of women, but you want to have some mix. So also in participatory budgeting, when do you want to have some mix of the project that you are going to fund? And this mix or diversity constraint can be with some thematic division, for example. So how can we find good algorithms for participatory budgeting that takes into account also this diversity constraint with respect to, say, thematic subjects? There are some ways or even many ways to approach it, and one way that we approach is the following. So we define groups of projects. So for example, take all of the projects that are concerned with education. This is one group, and simply declare some limit on the funds that you allow to spend on projects from this group. And now what you are ending up is with many groups of projects. For each of them, you have a group-wise budget, and you want to select a bundle that not only respect the total budget limit, but also respect the limit of each of the groups. So for example, you can say that I don't want to spend more than 70% of the total funds on projects in the city center, or you can have another constraint, I don't want to spend more than 60% of the total funds on projects that relate to transportation, and so on and so forth. So given this constraint, you can still want to somehow optimize, say, the total happiness of the voters from the resulting bundle, while respecting all of these group-wise budget limits. So this problem also, because of the combinatorial structure of the problem, is also NP-hard. But again, for some special cases, you can still find efficiently winning bundles that respect all of these constraints and maximize the total satisfaction or the total happiness. And for example, if there are only few groups, that you can still do it quite efficiently. Okay, so let me end with some more high-level view. So how can we help in designing and using better participatory budgeting processes? So if you want to do this, the first thing that you have to decide is the licitation method. So I personally like cumulative ballots. These are the ballot types in which each voter splits a virtual coin over the project. After you select the licitation method, what you have to do, you have to select the aggregation method. This is more tricky, but there are some algorithms that seems to be better than others. And how can you argue which algorithm is better? So again, you can use simulations and experiments, and you can use the axiomatic idea of defining properties and seeing which algorithm satisfied which properties. And what I think is even nicer is that it turns out that you can really deal sometimes even efficiently with interaction between projects, like positive and negative synergies between projects. And you can also deal with these diversity constraints. And something else that I didn't discuss before, you can integrate participatory budgeting with liquid democracy, in which voters can also delegate some of the decisions that they want to make to other voters. This gives even a more flexible and expressive way for voters to specify the preferences. So quite involved settings can be incorporated to participatory budgeting and still be rather efficient. And what I think, two concrete things that are still not well understood is, so one of them is, can we do a budget in an efficient way, in a hierarchical way? So for example, if you think about the way by which nationwide budgets are being decided. This is usually done in Africa. So you decide, okay, 20% of the budget I put in education and 30 I put on something else. And now this 20% I decide, so I make another decision how to split this 20%. So 10% is going to come to schools, 5% to universities, and so on. So there is like a tree-like hierarchical structure to how you do budgeting. But I think that currently there is still not a sufficiently well-behaving algorithmic way to do hierarchical budgeting efficiently. So this is one concrete goal for this line of research. And the different kind of goal that I think is still not very well solved is how to incorporate negative utilities into this participatory budgeting setting. So, for example, you can have a project proposed in some participatory budgeting, let's say to build a sports stadium in some place in the city. Now, some people will select this project because they like it. But for some other people, maybe the happiness that they have from this project is negative. Because if a person does not like sports and is living next to the place in which the city proposed to build a sports center, then this person is only going to have a hard time with this sports center if it will be funded because of noise and pollution and traffic. But currently, there is no way for voters to specify this kind of negative utilities to participatory budgeting settings. Okay, this is roughly all I wanted to say. So if there are any comments, questions, I will be happy to discuss further.
Thank you for such a great talk, Nimrod.
Just
I have a question. What is
yes.
really the difficulty with the negative utilities?
Sorry?
What is really the difficulty with negative utilities?
Well, so I'm not sure if it's really difficult, but currently this is not used. It's not completely clear what is the best way to do this. So in particular, how should the ballot look like? And what is the elicitation method? How do you ask to give you these negative utilities? And given that you set ballot, what
Okay, thank you. Yes, participants may ask questions. They can either type in the chat or just unmute themselves and ask.
So there is one question, how granular is the current complex plane? I'm not sure I understand the question. So if you can explain what you mean, then I'd be happy to.
PPT, you have written fine grain. Okay, the question is related to fine grain complexities.
Ah, okay, so this fine-grained liquid democracy. Okay, so I mean, I didn't discuss liquid democracy. The idea of liquid democracy in general is to each voter decide directly on the whether to go to the voting booth and to specify a name of some other voter to delegate all of the decisions. This is like not fine with the democracy of the fundamental model. I keep hearing some noise. Maybe this is for you. Paravi, can you mute? I think that I hear myself quite. Okay, so then and finally, budgeting would be that I can decide on some project that I like, some of them that I don't like, and some other project I can delegate the decision of whether I want to approve them or not to some other voices of my choice. So this would be like fine-grained liquid democracy. Okay. See something else? Okay, but this is not a question, so I cannot answer it. Okay, so
There is one more question involved in the chat.
yeah, but doesn't seem more like a rhetorical question. Okay, so any other questions? Okay, so if not, I guess that we can conclude.
Thank you so much for a great talk. And thanks the participants for joining. Okay, see you all next Monday. Bye.
Bye. Thanks for that.
Bye. Thanks for me.